Once again, I welcome everyone for this transfer pricing session. We have with us Mr. Mukesh Toomer, member of the NASSCOM SME Council. He holds the position of CEO and Managing Director at Parametrics Technologies, a software services company. Parametrics has wholly owned subsidiaries in Hong Kong, Singapore, and China. Mukesh is a driving force in the technology industry, having been an active member and contributor of NASSCOM's National SME Council, and has led several industry initiatives to enable better collaboration and higher standards across the board. So, without further ado, I'll now hand over the stage to Mr. Mukesh Toomer and request him to introduce our speakers. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Neha. Hey, good morning, friends, and welcome to this very important topic of transfer pricing, which seldom entirely is understood by the entrepreneurs of our SME communities. Some time ago, I think in the NASSCOM community group, someone had posted, and not someone, I think a lot of them had posted some issues related to transfer pricing. And we thought that it is best for us to brush up on this topic from a bird's eye view to begin with, since this topic is so large and complex that it cannot be covered in this 1 or 2 hours of session. However, I think our experts will give you a basic understanding of the subject. With this, without taking much time, I think I'll introduce you to our subject matter experts from Deloitte. And their introduction also, I won't take much time in introducing them, and I think we'll put their entire introduction on the chat. I think Neha, you can put their profile on the chat so that everyone knows about the profile as well. So we have with us Sachit Mujumdar and Pratik Maheshwari. So Sachit is a transfer pricing subject matter expert in Deloitte, and Sachit has over a decade of experience with transfer pricing. And Pratik also, he's from Deloitte and he's based out of Bangalore. He also has a lot of experience with transfer pricing. So we got both these experts to give us a bird's eye view of transfer pricing, which is a subject which is always, it has a lot of gray areas, definitely, and a lot of depth needs to be there to understand it entirely. Even those experts will have different opinions sometimes. But yeah, so having said that, I think they will talk about this topic much. With this, also, after they start their presentation, we will have a Q&A session. So I would request everyone to put on their questions as and when it comes over the chat. We'll pull it at the end of the session and try to take as many questions as possible. After the Q&A also, please wait for 2 3 minutes more. We'll have to, I mean, we are going to introduce you to Gagan, who is part of our GTD Global Trade Development team, and he would like to give, I mean, 5 minutes of this, and he would like to talk 5 minutes for opportunities for SMEs in Europe and Japan, the market development access opportunities there. So with that, I will hand it over to our experts to take this topic through for our knowledge session that will benefit all our SME community members. So over to you, Sachit and Pratik.
Thank you very much, Mukesh, and
Thank
thank
you,
you.
Mukesh.
I think it's at the outset, I must thank you for the opportunity. We are indeed both privileged as well as it's our pleasure to be presenting before you on the subject of transfer pricing. What we will seek to do in the next couple of hours is to try and deconstruct this fairly esoteric subject that has evolved considerably over the years into something that is more business and common sense, and then try and put some tax parlance around it. So at the outset, I would begin by saying that we are accustomed to transacting with what we call as related parties and unrelated parties. And as with transactions that customarily happen with related parties, there is under both company law as well as for corporate governance purposes, there is a requirement to look at transactions with related parties with a disclosure, from a disclosure lens. And the reason for doing so is because transactions with related parties could, not necessarily would, but could get influenced by the relationship between the parties. And that's the reason why Accounting Standard 24 or Section 188 of the Companies Act or SEBI listing and disclosure regulations deal with the requirement for obtaining board approval and shareholder approval for transactions that take place with related parties and with some riders such as ordinary course of business and at arm's length. Now, in what is important to understand here is that the regulations under company law or the regulations under listing guidelines, and for that matter, income tax, are not putting an embargo, as it were, on related party transactions. What they're seeking to do is that they're seeking to first and foremost disclose those transactions, and second, determine if those transactions are appropriately priced. In other words, looked at from a view of how they would have been relative to third party pricing. Now, the reason for doing so is fundamentally that any transaction that takes place between related parties could have a bearing on the relationship between the parties. In other words, the relationship between the parties may have led to a differential pricing or a differential terms of arrangement for the transaction than it would have been with third parties. It is stemming from this that transfer pricing not just goes into looking at transactions with related parties and therefore looks at disclosure, because pricing may have influenced the terms of the arrangement, but or in other words, the relationship may have influenced the terms of the pricing, but also that there is one more angle to it, which is that while, for instance, if you look at a company in India and another company in India, and the two companies are related by virtue of having common shareholders, for example, then you would expect that if the transaction has been influenced by the relationship, then it is possible that in one case, a goods or services may have been sold at a higher price or sold at a lower price, with the result that one of the entities, let's say the seller entity, and let's say that the seller entity sold it at a higher price, that seller entity will therefore end up with higher profits than would otherwise have been realized from unrelated parties. Now, other things being equal, what happens then is that because the relationship influences the price, the disclosure to the shareholders, the disclosure to the stakeholders is about saying that here's a transaction that may have been influenced by the relationship between the parties. And given that construct, there is no tax rate play, as it were. The only change that happens is that one entity may have ended up with a higher profit and the other entity, which is the buying entity, may have ended up with a lower. When it comes to cross-border, there are two elements at play. There is one, the ability to influence the transaction by way of price between the parties, and as a result, one entity may benefit more and another entity may benefit less because of the influence of the price. But there is also the fact that in one country there may be a tax rate that is at a higher rate, and in another country the tax rate may be at a lower rate. And therefore there is an opportunity not just to move profits between related parties, but also move profits with an intention to effectively reduce or increase tax costs. So if you think of two countries, and we could take the US and India as an example or a case in point, we would say that the US tax rate is 21, the India tax rate is 25, and therefore there is an opportunity potentially for somebody to sell goods into India at a higher price so that someone in the US is realizing greater profits that are taxed at 21%. India realizes lower profits that are taxed at 25%, and effectively there's a 4% arbitrage. Now that, in a nutshell, is the crux of transfer pricing, which is that it is not a matter of regulation, as it were, or it stems from regulation, but the regulation is disclosure, but it's a tax construct in order to ensure that transactions between related parties take place in a manner that is consistent with the transactions that take place in the open market, as it were, between unrelated parties. And therefore, this transaction methodology, which is to say, how do transactions take place between related parties and how do we equate them to transactions between unrelated parties, is the determination of what is called as the arm's length price. Now, price is one of those conditions. There can be other non-monetary or monetary conditions that may arise. For example, how much credit do I provide? For example, is there a difference between the quality of the goods that I offer to third parties and to related parties? So there could be changes in inventory levels. So there could be, and when I say that, I mean that I might offer an unrelated party a greater amount of inventory to keep at its disposal, simply because effectively if I'm a related party to another, then it is easier for me to shift inventory to that person's backyard, as it were, than it is for me to move it into unrelated party's backyard. So there are those kind of arrangements that can influence the pricing. But basically, it stems from the fact that two parties are related. One of them potentially has the ability to influence the actions of another. And therefore, the influence is manifested in the form of price. And therefore, the need for ensuring that between countries, the entities that are transacting in a manner where there is no ability for profit shifting, as it were, to take place, such that it is not a case where the rate of tax becomes a weapon of abuse, such that undue profits are parked in jurisdictions or countries that have low tax rates and lesser profits are parked in jurisdictions or countries that have higher tax rates. So that's the concept, and that is the fundamental construct of transfer pricing. As we can see, because it deals with related parties, because it deals with goods and services, because it deals with the nature of transactions, as it were, in a business parlance, the subject or the domain of transfer pricing is highly business centric. And it's again very, very fact and circumstance specific. So for example, if you take the COVID times, there could be a case where shops were closed for extended periods of time. And these extended periods of time were different in different countries. So in India, you had 3 months. In Australia, it may have been 6 months. So the relative duration, in Europe, we're seeing much more extended time frames of closure. So the extended time frames may play out very differently for different parties. And therefore, again, the question is that does this unforeseen risk, which is called a hazard, does it play into the transfer pricing arrangements that exist between companies in different jurisdictions and to what extent? So we, over the next several slides, go over these elements of the business, go over the elements of transactions, and figure out how at least at a superficial level, one could price transactions with a view to arrive at an arm's length outcome.
Yeah, thank you, Sachin. Thank you for summarizing this. I mean, clearly, what this is, what is the intent, how this legislation came into picture right in 2001. where the idea is that the pricing influence between related parties by way of legislation, that should be how it should ideally be in a uncontrolled transaction, in a comparable uncontrolled transaction, as they call. So that's precisely the intent, and this is what we will discuss over the subsequent slides. So if you look at this slide, this it just talks about a brief flowchart of what we discussed just now in terms of summarizing when will transfer pricing regulation apply. So whether there is a transaction between two enterprises, which is either giving rise to income or which has an impact on the profits or profits or losses of the company in India. If the answer to that is yes, then whether these two enterprises are associated, as we call in simple words, related parties, and one of them is non-resident. Of course, there are some conditions when even two non-residents has to be comply with the transfer pricing regulation. But for the purpose of this discussion, we'll stick to when one of them is non-resident, then yes, the transfer pricing regulations apply. And once the transfer pricing regulation applies, there are two basic compliance exercises which we have to undertake on a recurring basis. I mean, a year-on-year basis. One is the accountant's report in 3CEB, which is a certification exercise, and the other is a transfer pricing documentation to be maintained if the value of transactions exceeds 1 crore. So what is transaction is another discussion, and that is what we will discuss in the next slide. So when it comes to transaction, This is really wide, and this has a whole lot of activities covered, whether it is any transaction related to goods, any transaction related to services, intangibles, tangible assets, restructuring. So it covers a whole lot of exercise. When I say that goods, whether there is a purchase or a sale, any transfer of raw material or finished goods. And then when we move to services, any provision of services which is rendered by, say, an Indian entity to its related entity abroad, or vice versa, any services which is received by the foreign entity from India, whether in the nature of your routine, say, a software services, or it moves along in the nature of any intra-group services, what we call, which in simple terms, intra-group services means that any support service which, say, India is receiving, whether in the nature of legal, whether in the nature of finance, HR, administrative support, or any allocations around that, then any restructuring exercise. When I say restructuring exercise, to club it, maybe restructuring can go into two parts: one operational restructuring, or then one organizational restructuring, in the sense any merger, acquisitions, or any realignment of functions between two entities, two related entities. All these activities are covered under the definition of transaction. So to summarize, the definition of transaction itself is very wide for TP purpose, and per se, almost any of the transaction which is entered between two related entities gets covered under the transfer pricing ambit. So now when it gets covered, what's the next step is what that flowchart talked about. As it gets covered, basically from a compliance standpoint, the next step is those transactions goes into a 3CEB, and then you have to justify the arm's length of the transactions, which we will discuss subsequently. But the whole crux is that there is whole lot of transaction which gets covered. Then there is this capital financing transaction as well. If you look into it, any lending or borrowing transactions, whether loan taken or loan provided, that gets covered as well. So these typically are the transactions which falls under the transfer pricing ambit. There can be a bit more, and this is just illustrative. But the idea is to just highlight that quite that this transaction definition and this transaction coverage for transfer pricing purpose is really big, and this kind of transaction gets covered.
Yeah, if I may add 2 points. One being that transactions, as Pratik mentioned, the definition is very wide, and therefore we've not, for example, covered intangibles, but intangibles are at play in relation to everything to do with the licensing of software. So if you think of SaaS, if you think of platforms that are developed with and patented or copyrighted, they could be licensed out. And these transactions would then become a related party transactions that would have to be transfer priced. The second aspect is the definition of associate enterprises. We have to keep in mind that the construct of transfer pricing is one to do with international transactions and second to do with associated enterprises. Now, the definition of associated enterprises and international transactions, while it is not necessarily defined in the tax treaties, but we do have to recognize that both transfer pricing, the concept of transfer pricing, associated enterprises and international transactions is germane to, or in other words, embedded in both the Income Tax Act, which is our domestic tax law, and tax treaties that take place between countries. And there is a specific article, which is Article 9, which deals with associated enterprises. And the associated enterprises article also contemplates the transactions between associated enterprises taking place upstream. Now, the definition of associated enterprises is very wide. The short answer to this is that anybody holding 26% voting power would be an associated enterprise. And then there are a whole lot of other conditions. For example, if somebody is a supplier for more than 90% of goods and services, then that would be an associated enterprise. If someone has lent more than 50% by way of loans to another enterprise, then that would be it. That would also be regarded as an associated enterprise. If there is a dependency on IPR, then that would be an associated enterprise. So the definition of associated enterprise is very wide, including it extends to commonality of directors and board members. So there are, again, a lot of a number of conditionalities attached to associated enterprises. But the key to this is that the associated enterprises and international transactions are therefore of both wide import and of import in both the Income Tax Act as well as in tax treaties. And that's the reason why, to that extent, transfer pricing is a cross-border law. And I think to keep it very simple, any relationship that is influenced by control, capital, or management is in a way an associated enterprise. And an international transaction has some contours, but typical transactions, as Pratik has explained, are the ones that we've outlined.
So this is just an illustration of, I think, what we discussed at the concept slide, that why this came into the picture and how it can influence that based on different tax rates, which is adopted by different countries, how this can actually influence, how transfer price can actually influence the final taxable profit and the tax payable by the group. So if you look at this example, I'll just quickly summarize this. So say there is a manufacturer in country A, and then there are two manufacturers respectively in country B and country C. Suppose there is the cost of production, which is incurred by the manufacturer in country A, is say 200, and the final sale price here is around 500. So the total profit for both the scenarios is 300. Now look at transaction one and then transaction two. In first transaction, what we have done is that we have placed the transfer price at 400 rupees. And the transfer price for country A to say country B. And in transaction two, what we have done is we have placed the price, the transfer price at 300 rupees from country A to country B, country A to country C. So how this will work is that just focus for the moment, say at country B. Just by fixing up a transfer price at 400 rupees, what I ended up is saying that the total tax payable by the group is 23 of this 200 and then 40% on this balance 100. While if you look at the other scenario, there has been a lot more profit which is parked in country C in transaction 2 just because the effective tax rate of country C is on a lower side. So arbitrarily, the whole idea is that a lot less profits are parked in country B by increasing the transfer price and thus letting less profit be at the disposal of country B, effectively because there is a higher tax rate in country B vis-a-vis in the second scenario. More profits have been moved to country C because the effective tax rate was 12.5%, which is lower than the effective tax rate of country A and country B. Just to summarize, if you look here, had the transfer price been 300 for transaction 1, then in this numerical example, what would have happened is that the profitability which is there with country B, instead of being 100 rupees in the transaction 1, would have been 200 rupees, and thus there would have been more tax payable by the group, which was arbitrarily avoided by increasing the transfer price. So that's the intent. That's the intent based on which these regulations came into the picture. This inherent ability of multinationals to set the transfer price based on tax rates at different countries is what makes this a tax rate arbitraging, and hence there has to be a regulation in place which is this to eliminate that and to set up the process around a transfer pricing.
I just come in. I saw one question around of how it could apply to the software industry, and why we have quoted here a manufacturing example. We will see in subsequent slides how it operates for different categories of entities. But the short point is, it could apply equally to a development center in India that has a SaaS product or that has a software product that is distributed to customers in overseas jurisdictions. So think of an entity that is set up for distribution, as Pratik explained, country B distributor. Country B would be the US. India is the developer and the owner of the product, of the software product. It is asking distributor, its related party in country B, to distribute the software. And in the process, the distributor is keeping a certain margin. The Indian entity is keeping the profits from the development and the exploitation of the IP, and the distribution entity is getting its profits for distribution. Country C could, in fact, be an unrelated distributor. So think of Kenya, where it would be an unrelated distributor, and you could be giving the unrelated distributor a certain margin for its distribution activity, and potentially one could compare the margins that you're giving the unrelated distributor by way of a quote-unquote commission or by way of a profit that the distributor earns in Kenya with the distribution profits that the related party distributor in the US is earning. So we'll get to more examples, but we just wanted to address this one question.
Yeah. I'll just repeat this. I think quickly summarize, I think there have been a couple of questions around this explanation again. So say transaction one is a controlled transaction and say transaction two is an uncontrolled transaction. Now we park aside the manufacturing for the time being, and we assume that, say, it's a product development company, the country A. So say an independent entity would fix the transfer price when it is transferred from A to B, say at 300, while for the dependent entities, it has been intentionally fixed at, say, 400. So just by fixing a higher transfer price, since the final sale price is 500, just by fixing a higher transfer price, what has happened is that there is more profit at the disposal of country A, and then there is less profit at the disposal of country B. And the idea might be that because the country B has a higher effective tax rate. So arbitrarily, by fixing up a higher transfer price, what I have done is that I have left less profit at the disposal of country B, thus resulting in a lower tax payable to the group. In the sense that had I made this transfer price 300, then the effective profit which would have been available with country A would have been 100, and the effective profit which have been available to country B would have been 300, thus resulting in a higher tax than what is being paid currently by the group. So to summarize, I think what Sachin pointed out is correct, that irrespective of whether it's a manufacturing entity or a software product development entity, the idea behind this example is to highlight that the transfer price is to an extent a mean of tax arbitraging because of different tax rates at different countries. And so this has to be in accordance with what ideally should be with an uncontrolled transaction and in line with the arm's length principle.
Yeah, and to just supplement, and we will get to the next slide to drive home this particular point. The key to this is that country A, country B, for example, could be performing potentially the same functions. If they perform the same functions, then there could be the possibility of saying, look, I will shift profits from here to here. Now, the premise here is that the role of country A and the role of country B is the same, and therefore we are able to fungibly shift profits. But the answer is, in reality, that the roles of A and B are different. A is, that, for example, the developer, B, for example, is the distributor. And we will get to, in the very next slide, we will see how the roles of the parties, as it's called, the functional analysis of the parties, is a very essential determinant of what the transfer pricing arrangement should be.
Yes, sir. Hello. So this is just a quick summary of some of the key points for the functional analysis. So Chint, you want to set the context, and then we can take this.
So when we deal with a transfer pricing analysis, one of the key elements of a transfer pricing analysis is what is called as the function asset risk analysis. And there's actually a fourth element with which is market that's emerging, but let's just stay for the moment with function asset risk. Now, why do I say this? It's really to determine what is the role of an entity in a certain jurisdiction. And therefore, the role of the entity has a key role to play, or the functions performed by an entity has a key role to play in the manner in which you determine the so-called arm's length price for that entity's functionality. Now, if you think of a distributor and we think of a developer, the developer is the person who's generating the IP, and the distributor is somebody who is selling. Now, could, for example, you get an unrelated party developer? Potentially unlikely, because the IP is belonging to a entity that has developed the ground up IP from scratch and that holds potentially copyright or patent in respect of the software. Could you get an unrelated party distributor? Yes, you potentially could, because if somebody had to go and find customers, you could find an independent agent, you could find a dependent agent. Therefore, the answer could be that you may be able to find an independent distributor, but you may not be able to find an independent developer. So it's important to understand the company and the industry in which the company is positioned and what is the role that the entity is playing. Then we determine the intercompany transactions. Are they, as we went through a number of them, are they in the
Suchit got dropped off.
Yeah, I'll request him to join again. Meanwhile, yeah. Pratik, if you
so I'll take this up. Yeah. So what the idea is and what the context is, what context we are trying to drive here is that functional analysis is what forms the key to the transfer pricing analysis which we follow. So functional analysis in broad terms is a very wide term, and I think there is no one size fits all answer with regard to how should a entity be remunerated from a transfer pricing standpoint, and or what is the appropriate characterization. There are some myths which may be relevant to clarify. So at stages when we discuss this in and out with clients, so generally there is usually a discussion around that when it comes to transfer price. Say if I am a contract service provider, then what should ideally be, say, a cost plus markup which I should earn. So the idea is to set the context that, yeah, in many of the cases, depending on the functions which an entity perform or the risk which they assume, that can be the correct answer. But the point is that it all depends on what the functions each entity within, when it comes to an intercompany transaction, what function each entity is performing, and then what is the associated risk, which we will discuss in subsequent slides. But the context here is that identification of the potential risk, identification of what is the functions performed, and hence the characterization is what holds the key to the further analysis which is required to be undertaken. Yeah, Sujit.
Yeah, sorry, I lost everybody. So I was saying that it's also important to understand as to what is the risk profile of the entities and what risks are in their control. So think of COVID-19, and this comes back again and again, and we will keep discussing this. Is it a risk that can be assumed by one entity, or is it a risk that has to be assumed by the group? And if it is to be assumed by the group, then to what extent can a related party assume the risk of a hazard? To what extent can the related party assume the risk of a known hazard? For example, bad debts. Is that a known risk? Yes, it is. It is far more known than a COVID-19 risk. And therefore, what about, for instance, let's say inventory. Is that a risk? Well, it's both an asset and a risk. And therefore, both when it comes to determining elements of risk, and this could apply equally to R&D, whether the product will succeed or not, clearly the distributor has no gainsaying or no skin in the game, so to speak, insofar as R&D is concerned, because the distributor will sell what the developer gives, but the distributor cannot in any case contribute to the development activity that is undertaken by the IP owner or the entrepreneur. So when we think of the functional analysis and we think of function, asset, and risk, we're thinking function, for example, development is a function, any form of R&D is a function, any form of operation and maintenance is a function, any form of distribution and marketing is a function. So these are functions. Assets are in the software space, they're mostly intangibles, but they could be platforms, they could be software, they could be tangibles such as, for example, any hardware that one may have, but also contracts are intangible. So again, the distributor has certain intangibles, like he owns the contracts with customers. And that's an important and a valuable intangible. So functions, assets, and risks. Risks being, we spoke about bad debts risk, we spoke about market risk, we spoke about risk of failure of products. And these are therefore risks that have to be assumed by one party or the other or by both the parties. And it's important to understand as to which entity is capable of bearing the risk independent of how the risk is allocated. You could allocate a risk to an entity. You could allocate, for example, a product risk or risk of a product failing because it does not stand up to specifications to a distributor. But the reality is that the distributor is not in a position to control that risk. And therefore, the allocation of that risk and the consequences of allocation, which are higher or lower profits to the distributor, who is not in control of that risk, is purposeless. So therefore, you have to therefore think of function asset risk for each of the entities that's in the group, and to say, are they capable of utilizing those assets? Are they capable of performing those functions? Are they capable of bearing the risks? Do they have the capacity to bear the risks? And then every time you do that, look at the possibility of what is called as realistically available alternatives. What are those comparable, what are their comparable proxies that could exist to be determining the uncontrolled prices for the transactions, and then price those transactions? There's elements like location issues. Now, for example, Australia gave JobKeeper payments during the time of the COVID-19 crisis. And therefore, is that a location-specific benefit that may accrue, or that may, let's say, incentivize companies to go to Australia? Maybe it is. India has been long having a location-specific advantage for having certain engineering and design skills. So again, that could, on its own account, warrant a market premium. So there are other market factors as well, but it's overall important at an entity level to understand what are the functions being performed qua a certain entity.
Correct. So just to summarize this whole discussion, so how a transfer pricing exercise will work is that, suppose once it is established that there is an international transaction, and then there are two associated enterprise. As a next step, what we will do is that we will analyze first what are these intercompany transactions which we are discussing, and then the function, asset, and risk profile of the entities who are undertaking the transaction, that is at an entity level, and then maybe at a group level, that what's the contribution by these entities in the whole end-to-end process. So function, assets, and risk analysis thus forms the crux of this whole transfer pricing exercise, because that is precisely what will help you to summarize that within the group, with regard to the intercompany transaction, and also with regard to the group, what is my role and what is my extent of functions and what is the extent of risk which I am bearing. So just to take you to the next slide, these are some examples, and I'll just quickly cover, I think quite a few is what Sachin covered. So say when we say that we perform R&D function. Now, when it is R&D function, R&D includes a wide spectrum of functions, and it might vary on an industry to industry. It might vary from in a particular industry as well if the domains are different. For example, say if I say that I do software with regard to a chip processing exercise, chip processing entity. So how it works is that for them, R&D might be a lot more relevant than say any other in the industry where this is more of a process-driven exercise. So R&D, just because there is an R&D activity, the next step is to identify what is the role of that R&D activity in the whole value chain. I'll just give you one example. We had a recent experience some 5-6 months ago. with regard to this R&D exercise and identification of the role. So for this entity, what happened is that they were first a India outbound entity, and then they moved some of their key managerial personnels and the holding to the US. So they flipped the structure in the sense that a few people and the key people and the holding company moved to US. So while that exercise happened, what happened is that while some of the key personnels moved to a different location, which in this case is a US, the key decision makers with regard to the research activities which they were undertaking here were still sitting in India. So while they were still characterizing themselves as a contract R&D service provider, but per se the functions which were performed by the India entity was a lot more, was significantly higher when it might not be the case for other contract service providers. So to summarize, what is the key function which the entity is performing? Who allocates the budget? Say, what happened if the budget goes wrong? What happened if the R&D doesn't work and then there are losses? Which is the entity one who will bear the loss? And also whether the entity who is bearing the loss has the financial capability to bear the loss. So these are some points which requires immediate attention when we do a functional analysis, because that is what is the crux of us to characterize that what is the function performed with regard to the transaction, and then in the overall value chain of the group, how relevant is that process. And that will form the crux of subsequent things to follow, that what should be the transfer price, what should be the arm's length price and methods, etc. Similarly, for say a product strategy and design, which is the entity who is taking the key role with regard to the strategy of how this product should be developed, with regard to the design, anything else with regard to say a strategic management. Which is the entity with regard to the transaction who is controlling the finance or who is taking the key decisions with regard to the finance? For a market, say for example, also say marketing and distribution entity. So say if I am a marketing entity in India, say for example, what is the function which I am performing? Whether the function which I am performing is just getting a global, say, global documents, say brochures, and I just advertise that here, or I just advertise that here, or whether I am involved as an Indian entity, I'm involved in designing the advertising process and determining what should be the budget. So these are the key factors, very fact specific, of course, and it is not, as I said earlier as well, it's not a one size fits all answer, a very fact specific exercise. But the idea is that at every intercompany transaction level, we have to analyze that between the parties involved, which is the party who is performing the key functions, and or if both are performing key functions, what is the level of functions being performed by both the parties to move this further to determine what should be the appropriate remuneration model. Of course, risk then follows with functions. With regard to the function, say when I say that there is an India entity and then say a US entity, India is the holding company who takes the key decisions with regard to risk, R&D, with regard to what should be the budget, etc. If that is the case, then the related R&D risk stays with India. Similarly, if India is the entity in an example where they are the one who is directly entering into a contract with customer, then they automatically become liable for say a collection risk or a credit risk, which might not be the case if the contracts are being entered into by my cross-border entity with the customer, and then I don't get into the business risk and market risk. So to summarize, a fact-specific exercise, but what is the actual functions performed by the entity in the transaction, whether R&D, marketing, assembly, strategic management, financing, and then the corresponding associated risk that say there is an economic downturn, then who will bear the risk, whether that risk will get passed on to me or whether my holding company or my associated entity is the one who is bearing the risk or vice versa. Similarly, collections, credit, foreign exchange. So these are the parameters based on which it will be decided that how should this transaction be priced. Of course, there can be certain situations where, say, I'll give you an example that say I am a contract service provider and with a holding company in US, and they are the one who are bearing all the risk, and I just get to provide certain services and go ahead and provide that. But say, for example, as Sachin was saying, let's say take COVID for an example. If because of COVID, my industry is severely impacted, say I'm into a travel and tourism industry and hence it is severely impacted at the holding company level. If that is the case, then it might so happen that irrespective of me being a simple contract service providing entity, I might have to bear a portion of the market risk or any other associated risk, which has to be analyzed if there are certain specific cases. But to summarize, these are the factors which needs to be taken care of mind and when we go into the economic analysis point. Next slide. Yeah, this is just a summary of the relevance of the functional analysis which we discussed in the previous slide and how it helps actually to characterize the entity with regard to the intercompany transaction. So say after the functional analysis of the functions and the risk analysis, a conclusion is drawn that I am the entity who is not bearing majority of the risk. Say India is the entity who is not bearing majority of the risk, and most of the risk or the functions which are being performed are being done by the associated entity. Say, for example, that I get the budget, I don't take part in the budget, I get what I have to do, I perform the service and I give it back to them. Then they are the one, say, who enter into contract with customers, and they are the one who determine the customers and bear the associated risk. Say, if the India entity, say, fall in that category or domain, then I move to a low function, low risk kind of an entity, which is like a contract service provider or a limited risk distributor, where I get the product, I sell it off, or the principal sell it off, and I'm just involved in transformation process while I'm just taking the product and giving it off to the customer without doing a lot exercise locally in terms of distribution and in terms of marketing. So then broadly it comes into two category, a low function and a low risk, and then a high function and a high risk. And that is based on the category in which the FAR analysis helps us to conclude is what will follow the subsequent steps in terms of how should we benchmark. We will also discuss this in a bit more detail on each category, that what in majority of the cases, ideally a transfer pricing model, if once we are done with the characterization and once we actually know what is our character based on our functions performed.
Yeah, I think the short point to take away is that you will normally get comparable companies for low function and low risk, and you are not likely to get comparable companies for high function and high risk. And therefore, when you look at low function and low risk, that's the kind of companies that you should find out when you map the organization and characterize the organization, the entities in the organization, or at a group level, you would simplistically say that this particular entity is high function, high risk, this particular entity low function, low risk. And it is normally possible to find out comparable companies for low function, low risk, and price transactions with the low function, low risk in an easier manner than it is to find comparables for a high function, high risk. And effectively, the residual profit, therefore, sits or stays, or the residual loss tends to stay with the high function, high risk entities. And the low function, low risk entities tend to get what are called as benchmark returns. Go ahead, Bill.
Just 1 second, interrupting you both. Sachin and Pratik, I think just to give you an analogy, that the example that you take, probably it would be very apt for the audience here to correlate to themselves, would that most of the SMEs will have their effective, holding company rather in India, and they will have subsidiaries outside of India. So if we have those kind of examples when we are explaining these slides, would be more correlating to the audience here out, right? So it's just a suggestion. So you can take those examples so that it will be more interesting for them as well to understand. Right. Thank you. Go ahead, please, Pratik.
Yeah. So there is a question. I think I'll take it up once I'll just cross this this hurdle of this economic analysis part. So this is what Sachin was actually talking about, is that we have to identify that which is the entity in the intercompany transaction, which is a simpler one and which is a more complicated one. So just to set the context, say for example, there is a manufacturer. There is a manufacturer in India, software manufacturer, say for example, and then they have a distributor in Malaysia, similar to what example was there in the Q&A. There is a manufacturer in India, and then there is a distributor. There is a price at which the India entity is providing the software to the Malaysian entity. Now, first we'll have to analyze that based on the functions, which is the entity who is performing a relatively higher function as compared to the other entity. Say we take an example that India is the one who is performing higher function, and then the Malaysia entity is just a distribution entity who is taking up and distributing. Say in the example which we got in Monday, a 100 rupees is what is coming to us, and 110 rupees is what I am giving it to my end customer. Now, what should ideally be a remuneration module will depend on who is performing what functions. So say when we say that I am a distributor whose role is very limited to just take it up and sell it off, and at the end of the day, say the inventory risk or the market risk or the contract related risk is borne by the India entity, then how transfer price will be fixed is that the distributor in Malaysia will get an assured return on whatever sales they make, which can be a percentage of sales they make, depending on the functions, of course. And then the balance might come back to India. In the second scenario, if the distribution entity performs all the functions which a distributor ideally performs, then how this will shift is that they will get more returns than what they were getting in the first case. And in that case, it might happen, just depending on the fact, but it might happen that they pay India out for whatever product they have received, maybe in terms of a royalty fee or a license fee, and then they are the one who retain the balance profits which they get when they sell it to the end customer. To summarize that, yes, transfer price will need to be fixed when there is a transfer from, in this example, the India entity to the Malaysian entity. Then what should be the transfer price? What should be the appropriate model based on which this transfer price will be fixed is what will depend on the functions with regard to the transaction, which the India entity and the Malaysian distributor is performed. And if it's a low risk, low function, then they might get a fixed return on sales and balance might move back to India. And if there is a high risk or a routine distributor, they might retain a more portion of the profits. And what might come back to India is maybe a kind of a license fee or any other model. But the crux is that there will be more profit because that will commensurate more with the functions which a distributor will perform, say outside India, and vis-a-vis a case when the distributor is performing limited function. And that to an extent correlates to this simpler versus complex concept is that, say the India entity in this example is a complex entity and the Malaysia entity is a simpler entity. So what we will end up doing is that we will end up finding independent comparable companies performing similar distribution function as the Malaysian entity is undertaking in an ideal scenario, so that we can fix that appropriately what should be the remuneration which the Malaysian entity should keep. So where, for which entity the transfer price needs to be fixed in a transaction is what depends on the concept of which is the entity who is performing a simpler function, because it's easier to identify comparable transactions uncontrolled for a simpler entity vis-a-vis a complex entity. Does that to an extent answer the question set up in the chat box? Yeah. Okay. I think this SAS, the question with regard to SAS is something which we'll take it up at the end on the Q&A session.
Pratik, Nilesh said yes. That's fine. That was Nilesh's question, so I think he says yes, it answered this.
Correct. Okay. So I'll just move on. So as we move on, so just to set the stage again quickly. So the steps will be identification of transactions, associated enterprises, and then we'll do a functional analysis. Once we are done with the function and risk analysis, we are clear with 2-3 points. One, we are clear with which is the simpler entity and which is the complex entity in terms of functions. Second, we are clear that what is the characterization of each entity in the sense that whether, say, if it's an India outbound, whether the foreign entity is a contract service provider with India being an entrepreneurial entity, or it might so happen that the foreign entity might be entrepreneur entity if we say that there is a foreign market and then the entity has been set up just to capture that market. So for the purpose of any particular transaction, it might so happen that the other entity is also the entrepreneurial entity. Assuming that we take that the India is the entrepreneurial entity and then the foreign entity becomes the contract entity or a limited risk entity. Now, I'll not very detailed touch upon each of these methods because this is one full exercise for a complete session. But what I would like to summarize here is that broadly in terms of methods, once we are clear with the characterization, we will have to analyze that how we need to benchmark. I mean that whether benchmarking it at a net profit level is an ideal way to benchmark, or we should benchmark it in a gross level, or if, say, based on the transaction undertaken, it is assumed that both the entities are equally relevant to the transaction and both has their own IP. Say, for example, that one has the technology, the other has the process, or in one way or the other, it is established that both these entities are very relevant to the transaction, then there can be a split of entrepreneurial returns as well. But just to summarize, these are broadly the methods based on which the transactions can be benchmarked with, say, for example, a resale price or a cost plus method, ask for benchmarking at a gross level, whereas a transaction net margin, ask for benchmarking at a net level. But we'll not just dig a lot too deep, but just, this is just a quick summary of once the characterization part is done, it just goes into how should this be benchmarked. This we will skip. I think this is just, yeah. And now comes the value chain analysis. Suchint will add a lot more to it, but I'll just quickly summarize this in terms of, see, a value chain analysis is nothing different from a functional analysis to summarize. But this has of late picked up after a lot of changes around, there has been a lot of discussions around BEPS, and there is a base erosion happening. So now holistically, while functional analysis talks about transaction level analysis, the value chain analysis, what it talks about is that at a whole entity level, that how end to end the function is performed, and then what is the role of individual entities in the transaction. So that gives a more holistic view of how should we fix up the transfer price. So Chint, you can take it up.
Yeah, thanks. So the core of the OECD and inclusive framework work has been around what is called as aligning profits with value creation. And when we speak of allocating profits to where value is created, we are not referring to where IP is held or where capital is mobilized, but really where activities are performed. Those activities can be development activities, they can be market creation activities, they can be activities in relation to even elements of contributing to the IP. Now, let me give you an example. Consider an Indian entity that sets up a holding company in Singapore. The role of the holding company is to do three or four things. One, to mobilize capital. Second, to register the IP. Third, to act as a super distributor for the group, whereby the group will then appoint a distributor in US, in Africa, in the Middle East, and in Europe. And these distributors are market-facing entities that will effectively interact with customers, seek, solicit orders. They will pass them on to the Singapore entity. The Singapore entity will get development done in India. In effect, when you think of who's creating the value, and who's building substance, it's probably the Indian entity because they have the people and who are building the software. That then there are people in the respective, in countries like the Middle East and in Africa and in the US who are actually going and seeking customers. And then there is this IP holding company in Singapore that is in effect an aggregator. The only role that it is playing is to mobilize capital, but in effect, the rest of it is coordination activity. And when you think of what is value creation and how should profits be allocated to the US, to Middle East, to say Germany, to India, and to Singapore, you would, when you follow the principles of value chain, and the value chain here is that if you think of it from a value chain standpoint, we think of the entities lined up in the manner in which they are creating or adding value. Then it's first the Indian entity, then the Singapore entity, then the US entity. For example, if our value chain was the India, Singapore, US, but you would find that the value creation takes place one in the US because that's the market jurisdiction. And therefore, there is value in the user interaction and the inputs that are provided, the ability for the US entity to seek and gain customers. And then there is value created because the Indian entity is undertaking development activity. And this development activity is again a source of creation of value. In effect, the Singapore entity is providing a coordination activity, and therefore, because of its coordination role, it essentially should get a smaller share of the profit. So when you think of the value chain, therefore it becomes important to think of the value chain being the value creation functions for the respective entities, and therefore how should this the profits be allocated depending on the functions that are performed by each of the entities. So when we spoke of functional analysis, the functional analysis discussion was respective to an entity. When we speak of value chain, it is for the group as a whole. We can go to the next slide. Now, when we speak of value chain analysis, this is an example of providing the value chain analysis through the system. We have an IP company, which is essentially doing the R&D activity. We have a procurement entity, and I gave the example of a Singapore entity, which could potentially be the central procurement entity. Then there could be a manufacturing, or in other words, the development entity. And then there could be the selling entity. So this is really the value chain that could apply to a services organization. It could apply to a manufacturing organization, because ultimately the elements that are there, if you take, for example, a fabless semiconductor company, then there is R&D involved in the design of the IC. There is going to be activity involved in hiring a contractor in the nature of a TSMC or equivalent for purchasing functions. There is a production function involved, which is essentially the design activity that takes place in, let's say, in India, which is the hub of the fabless design activity and the development activity. And then there's this distribution activity, which could take place in the US, but it could potentially get supervised or controlled by a Singapore entity. But in effect, when you think of what are the drivers of value, potentially the large drivers of value are in fact the IP company that's generating the core of the product, and potentially the entity that is facing the market and generating customer orders, with possibly the Singapore entity playing a subservient role. So I think while it's important, when we speak of Indian holding company and then what do we have in different jurisdictions, the ability to assign value and to allocate the profits in, let's call it the ratio, and this is not truly a ratio exercise, but just let's just say the ratio of value creation becomes an important aspect of transfer pricing analysis, because you do the benchmarking for activities and for functions which can be measured with other parties, but you don't do a benchmarking for activities that are entrepreneurial in nature. And this value chain allows you to determine who are the organizations in the entire organogram that are generating value in measurable different contributions. So now when we come to, when we think of value chain analysis, we think of it as a supply chain analysis. But really the point is, the value chain analysis goes further, because it one deals with intangibles, and there's an increasing greater focus on intangibles than there used to be in the past, when that was a production heavy environment. So when we deal with supply chain analysis, we are largely dealing with components that go into the elements of the supply chain alone, but they do not take into account brand, they do not take into account intellectual property, they don't take into account customer relationships, and this is where the supply chain analysis in a way gets superseded by the value chain analysis, because the value chain puts the whole group under the lens and says, where is the value being created for the different functions that are being performed by the group. And through a qualitative and a quantitative analysis, one is able to allocate such profits to wherever the such sources of value are determined. And that's how there is the, and it involves therefore risk allocation, and it involves the determination of what are relatively high value functions versus what are low value functions. And low value functions are those that normally have proxies that normally have comparables that normally a company would outsource to any third party without the risk of it getting compromised in the process. So you wouldn't, for instance, allow your intellectual property to be developed by somebody else. You might not allow significant customer relationships to be entertained by somebody else. So those are the aspects or the examples of what one would regard as being high value and low value functions under a value chain analysis. This is again something to do with how the value chain analysis and the value drivers then is a determinant for the transfer pricing method. So once you've identified the value drivers and you've identified what creates the value, then you say that where does that value driver actually lie in the organization structure or the group structure. So you've determined value drivers. Value drivers can be R&D, it can be the customer relationship, it can be many manufacturing or development processes. For example, if your business is outsourcing, then maybe the ability to simply deliver at scale could be a value driver. So value drivers are first identified, that you localize those value drivers. You identify to which entity do the value drivers belong. And value drivers typically come with attendant risks as well. So you then for identify the value drivers, map them to the value chain, then you build the function analysis because you map those value drivers and the sources of value creation to the activity process in the chain, and therefore you identified the relative entity that is performing anything that is giving rise to value, and then you are able to therefore apply a transfer pricing method to the entity which is identified as the so-called low risk, low function entity that potentially can be benchmarked. And you also identify which are the entrepreneurial entities that normally should not be benchmarked because they will be the sources of residual profit or residual loss. So therefore, a value chain analysis is a group-wide exercise, a functional analysis is a entity-wide exercise, and therefore typically a value chain analysis is the starting point, and then from that you build up functional analysis, and then from that functional analysis you start undertaking benchmarking based on the relative strength of the transfer pricing method.
Yeah, quite aptly summarized, Sachin. I mean, yeah, that's broadly what it is. I mean, a value chain analysis and then a functional analysis, which helps us to do this characterization. Now, this will summarize a lot of our discussion and maybe some of the questions which are there in the Q&A on how should in different scenarios, ideally, a transaction should be benchmarked. So it can still be subjective in the sense that it's not an answer that a transaction has to be benchmarked on a cost plus method in every scenario for a contract provider. But broadly, this is broadly what happens. So say for example, a service provider. Broadly, there can be three buckets. One, a contract service provider also supports service activity. Say for example, an India company set up a subsidiary in a foreign location who is assisting me with some software related support as and when I require. So if I look at this, suppose that foreign entity doesn't perform any service for itself, but what it does is that it performs all the services only for me, which is the Indian entity. If that is the case, they don't bear any market risk. Ideally, there is no fluctuation, forex fluctuation. If they are not contracting with the customers, they don't bear the contract risk, the associated foreign exchange fluctuation risk. If all these parameters satisfy in any transfer pricing transaction, then yeah, the foreign entity will be a low function, low risk entity. And then in most of the cases, the remuneration model may be a cost plus model or a standard rate card model, depending on what is more appropriate based on functions. But But to put it up, if actually it is established that this is the low risk entity, then it is a cost plus model. On the other hand, if it is established that they are the full risk bearing entity, or they, for example, when they were performing the functions there, they ended up developing certain intangibles, which can be, say, a process related intangible or a marketing related intangible. If they have during the process developed any intangible, or the functions, the level of functions which has been performed is not like a contract service provider, they identify their own market and then they bear the associated risk in the local country, then the transfer price ideally shift from a, say, a cost plus model to a residual profit model or a profit sharing model, which will have to be analyzed depending on what the fact is. But to put it precisely, a low risk entity can still go with a remuneration model, which can be an incentive based on a cost. What should be the markup over and above cost is another discussion, which requires a separate exercise for a benchmarking and based on the functions which they are performing. But yeah, in terms of model, this can broadly be what it is. We have added one more category here in the contract service provider. This is similar to an example which I gave earlier, where I say that the holding company shifted to USA, for example, but India still performs a lot of functions with regard to these contract services, and some of them are specialized functions. Say, for the sake of this group, maybe we flip it and say that India is the holding company and say US has been set up as a contract service provider, but they perform a lot of functions there in the US, which is key to the overall, say, a value chain analysis and the functional analysis. Then they might be a contract service provider, but a cost plus may not be an answer. And then we may have to analyze that whether they should also get entrepreneurial returns for their, say, R&D effort. So this is broadly two summary that even in a contract service provider, if it is outsourcing, while the Indian company still maintains, gives the overall direction and maintains control, then still a cost plus model might work. But having said that, if there the functions which is performed by, say, a US subsidiary is more than what an ideal contract service provider would do, then the answer might be that cost plus might not be an appropriate model. Actually, of late, after base erosion and OECD guidelines on 2017, so last 2-3 years or maybe 4 years, there has been much more focus on establishing the actual conduct of the parties to the transaction vis-a-vis the contract. I mean, contractually, you can say that India still assumes all the risk, but it is very important to actually understand that in actual conduct, what is happening. If the actual conduct is in sync with the contract, then well and good. You can, the contract still forms the starting point of the discussion. But if in actual conduct you differ from what is there in the contract, so then you need to appropriately change the remuneration model, or you need to appropriately decide on the remuneration model. Similarly, for distributors, there can be various categories depending on the risk appetite or the risk which the entity is undertaking. Say our foreign subsidiary is only a sales support entity, or our foreign subsidiary can be a commission agent, or what I call a sales agent, where I still the principal contracts with the end customer, but they helps in the negotiation, or they do some local functions around that agency activity on behalf of the principal, then they might be entitled to a commission. Or similarly, they become a limited risk distributor or a full-fledged distributor. I say a limited risk distributor. How it works is that, say, the India entity has set up an entity in Malaysia, and then they are the distributor. So the first thing which we'll have to analyze is that, to what extent are the functions which they are performing, in the sense that if I still continue to bear the market risk, I still continue to bear the inventory risk, and what the local distributor simply does is buy the product and resell it to the customer, then they are entitled to a lower return as compared to when, if say I move to a full-fledged distributor. So to summarize, this is all fact specific, but as we move up the value chain and functional chain in terms of actual function which is performed by India versus the foreign entity, as we move up, we may have to decide on what should ideally be a model. For a low risk, it can still be a cost plus, it can still be for a distributor, it can still be as a percentage of sales which is lower, and as we move higher, the percentage might get higher. And if I move to say a full-fledged distributor who is undertaking all functions on its own in the foreign country, then it might shift to they getting the entrepreneurial returns and maybe passing it on to India based on limited function which India is performing with regard to that transaction. So a very fact-specific exercise, but yeah, as we move up the functional profile, the manner in which a transfer price should be determined changes.
Yeah, I just want to comment to say that there is this temptation to interpose companies that exist between, let's say, the Indian entrepreneur or the Indian holding company and, let's say, a US distributor. And this is the classical example of the Singapore intermediate company, which could host the IP and which could hold the contracts that the US has. So, for example, the Singapore entity then enters into a contract with the US. US in turn is holding contracts with customers. And for record purposes, the Singapore entity is the IP holding company. Now, on paper, it looks good because the Singapore entity is the owner of the intellectual property and is in a position to license this intellectual property or ask the US entity to distribute this license. But the fact is that when you look at what are the economic activities at the back of this, when you find that all of this is very contractual, and the real economic activity, the functional, the operations that go behind the development of the IP potentially are taking place in India. The market creation activity is taking place where customers are actually located, which could be in the bank. And so therefore, the Singapore entity is largely a contractual structure that does not have a significant role to play in the process. And therefore, when you look at the concept of a distributor, maybe the US entity is in fact a full-fledged or a limited risk distributor, but clearly there doesn't seem to be much of a role for the Singaporean intermediate holding company. So that's a point that we need to be careful about considering, because up until, let's say, 2017, this was not given adequate importance. But with the point about aligning what is called as aligning profits with value creation, or allocating profits where a value is created, and the concept of value creation being defined in the construct of economic activity and interaction with the market, interaction with people that create the substance behind behind the product. It's not just who owns the title to a contract, or no, it's not only the person who has the legal ownership, but in fact, who owns it economically speaking, who owns it from a functional perspective. That becomes quite important and relevant.
Yeah, I think that's what will form the crux of this whole. I think this 1.5 hour discussion, the whole crux is that transfer price will have to be decided. To summarize, transfer price will have to be decided when there is a transaction between two associated entities. From whose end the transfer price will be decided will depend on the fact that in the transaction, which is the least complex entity, and the entity which will be least complexed will be analyzed vis-a-vis independent comparables. And then what should be the transfer pricing model or the method will depend on actually with regard to the transaction, and then further with regard to the whole entity value chain, which is the entity, what is the function which is being performed by entity, and then based on the functional profile and the risk appetite, the appropriate model will be decided, which can be a fixed remuneration model for a low function performing entity and a higher remuneration or entrepreneurial return model based on higher functions which is being performed by the entity. Now for distributors, sales can be the driver for determining the percentage of fixed returns, whereas for service providers, cost can be a driver to determine, for a contract service provider, say for example, cost can be a driver to determine the fixed return. So what can be the driver can vary, but summarily, precisely, low risk can get an assured return, while as we move up the value chain, we will either have to get a higher returns on the same value driver or maybe an entrepreneurial return. Distributor versus a
Prateek, I think there is some network issue at your end.
This is just if we are acting as an agent, if my subsidiary is acting return vis-a-vis if they, and then I'm doing much more marketing spends in that foreign country, and based on that marketing spends, I'm creating some marketing intangible vis-a-vis by competitors, then it goes into a different discussion, and then ideally I should be remunerated for creating that intangible as well. This we can skip. I think this is just a summary of the entire thing we discussed. Just to give a quick highlight, this is what is the route which ideally should be followed. We'll do a function and risk analysis. Once we have identified the transaction, we'll do a functional and risk analysis and then do a characterization. Based on the characterization, we'll be in a position to select how should ideally this be benchmarked and what should be the appropriate method, which will be the tested party in the sense that a simpler entity with regard to the transaction. And then of course, a comparability analysis, which is a separate exercise, that how we identify the comparable companies and determine an appropriate arm's length price.
Yeah, I would just add to say that when we deal with the economic analysis, it's used for both price setting and then for price testing. It's important for companies to develop a transfer pricing policy based on a value chain analysis. And it is important to do this because even for the purpose of listing and even for the purpose of company law, a transfer pricing policy, whether domestic or international, becomes a matter of corporate governance. And the basis of how you arrive at the transfer price, how you arrive at pricing intercompany transactions, how you characterize the entities, needs to be in a way captured in a transfer pricing policy. In larger corporations, it forms part of what is called as a master file. But at the level of, let's say, more simpler corporations that are having multinational operations, it should be in the form of a transfer pricing policy, wherein you document what is the characterization of each of the entities, why you believe that they are sources of value creation, and to what extent and how you're going to be remunerating them. So let's say that there was an Indian principal company that had a development center in the Philippines, then you would say that we are going to give them, for example, a cost plus 9%, because that is how we expect comparable companies based on our analysis to be functioning. And so the policy is defined as a contract service provider in the Philippines will receive a cost plus remuneration that is tentatively benchmarked at 9%. On the other hand, if it was a US distributor of, let's say, a SaaS product, then you would say that US distributor will be given a return on sales of, for example, 3%, because we expect that comparable distributors would receive this kind of compensation. So documenting a transfer pricing policy is important. That's not a substitute for a documentation on an annual basis, but it does form the guidance for any form of due diligence that may be undertaken as and when fundraising takes place or an acquisition takes place, or it forms the basis of even any form of a subsequent compliance documentation.
So this I'll just quickly brush it up, and this is just, I think there was a question as well, and that what is the compliance, is 3CB a monthly exercise? So 3CB is a yearly exercise. What we have to do is that at the 30th October is the timeline. Earlier it was 30th November, now it has moved 1 month before the return filing for the entity. This is a accountant certificate where we need to certify what are the international transactions which has been undertaken by the entity during the year, and then what is the arm's length price, and then what should be the appropriate method to benchmark the transaction. So this is what the 3CB certifies. Actually, as a process, a company has to first maintain a transfer pricing documentation where they will do the functional analysis, they will document this, they will do an economic analysis based on the functional profile and this whole documentation exercise. And based on that documentation, a 3CB has to be maintained. Both are yearly exercise. Ideally, a documentation has to be completed before a company files a 3CB in an accountant certificate in 3CB. This is a CA certified document, which has to be certified by a chartered accountant. There is, of course, there is a threshold that if your value of international transaction is less than 1 crore, then you don't have to maintain a transfer pricing documentation. Having said that, actually from a governance standpoint, maybe a documentation is not required, but irrespective of your value being lower than 1 crore, at least we should have set the transfer pricing policy correct, and then we should have the intercompany agreements in place from a governance standpoint. And 3CB, of course, is required even if there is a one value of international transaction.
I think if we can move to the aspects of disputes focus on only three things, prevention, containment, and resolution, then we can wind it up in 3 minutes.
Yeah, sure, Sachin. So I'll just move to the same slide. So now we just come to a dispute resolution mechanism in India. So if once a transfer pricing is once a transfer price is established and there is a question by the revenue authority that this may not be an appropriate, so there are two things. One, we can follow a preventive approach where once we establish a transfer price, the regulation allows us to enter into a advanced pricing agreement with the other entity country. There can be a unilateral agreement where we enter into an APA with Indian competent authorities, and then what will happen is that between the entity and the competent authority, we'll agree to a transfer pricing model, and then what should be the appropriate arm's length price. Say, for example, if we both agree to a cost plus based on the functional profile, then what should be the appropriate cost plus markup. And once that is established between India and between the entity and the competent authority, there is an agreement which is signed by the entity, and that agreement will help you not have any litigation and act as a preventive document. So you will not have any litigation once you have an AP agreement signed. Similar is with there is a safe harbor rule prescribed which might be relevant for us for SMEs, because safe harbor anyways has a threshold, and for entities like us, we can enter into a safe harbor with the Indian authorities where there is a fixed rate. We have to decide on the functional profile. Say, for example, for software, the safe harbor says that a cost plus 17% if our threshold is till a particular limit, and then cost plus 18% if it is more than a particular limit. So Safe harbor is another option which we have. Once we enter into a safe harbor and there is an audit, we do our functional verification happens, and once that is done, we are not subject to any further litigation. Similarly, there can be a bilateral APA program where the India competent authority and say we have a transaction with US, and then the US competent authorities, they sit across and then they agree to a particular rate similar to a unilateral APA. But what benefits is that whatever additional in case additional income is being recognized in India, the corresponding credits you get in the foreign country jurisdiction. So broadly, there are some preventive measures available, to summarize, which can be in the form of an APA or a safe harbor. Otherwise, if we don't opt for a preventive measure, there is a normal litigation route which comes up. So in case it is picked up for scrutiny, there is a transfer pricing officer level assessment. And then if there is an adjustment which is made by the officer, you can move to a dispute resolution panel or CIT appeals, and then to the income tax tribunal, and then High Court or Supreme Court if required. Primarily High Court or Supreme Court, till date doesn't quashes the transfer pricing cases, because they don't say it as a subject as a question of law. But yeah, as a framework, a TPO level audit, TPO level assessment happens, and then based on if the adjustment is sustained, and if the entity is not comfortable with the adjustment, they move to a dispute resolution panel and then to the tribunal, which becomes the final fact finding authority. Other than this, of course, there is a MAP process as well, which is driven by a treaty, which is similar to APA, but the difference between an APA and MAP is that once you have a litigation and then you want to settle it between India and say the US competent authorities, you enter into an MAP, the MAP is entered into, and then the competent authorities between themselves discuss and arrive at an appropriate transfer price. So these are some of the mechanisms which are available. This is just a summary. I'll just take 2 minutes and summarize this in terms of recommended best practices, and then we can take up the Q&A. So best practices, what we should follow when we set up a transfer price, the necessary backup documents to justify whatever characterization we are doing. When we say a contract service provider, we should have sufficient documents to justify that functions are being performed by the other entity and they are the one who are bearing the risk. So our transfer pricing documentation holds key to justify or to document what actual characterization we are doing is in line with the actual conduct. Intercompany agreement, of course, is the starting point and has to be there, and which is followed by group policy and how we characterize and take and the backup documents. Say, for example, intra-group service, what are the kind of email correspondences and backup documents we give. Conduct over contract, this is very relevant, especially after the BEPS action plans and OECD revised guidelines. Only a contractual arrangement where, say, for example, India is assuming all the risk will not work in actual conduct. India should assume the risk which is there in the contract. Intra-group management services, I discussed briefly. I think we need to maintain, whenever we have arrangements like we are doing legal support or any other support from any of the group entities, what we should do is that we should keep sufficient documents like communications and minutes of the meeting, etc., to justify that the benefits are actually received. And then, of course, dispute resolution mechanisms. I think if we take a preventive route, enter into a safe harbor or an APA upfront, get clarity on what should ideally be the transfer price, and then you are sorted in terms of litigation, any further litigation in this regard. Yeah, that's it. I think annexures is okay. We can skip. Yeah, we can take up the questions. Okay.
Thank you. Thank you. Thanks a lot, Pratik and Sujit. Now, I think most of the questions were almost answered by you, but I'll just take the first question, which is Pramit Shetty's question. It's a long one, but I think you have explained that over the presentation as well. So he's saying that whether the transfer pricing is applicable to a distributor kind of arrangement where they have a subsidiary which is just putting up a markup of $1 over a $3 cost. So it's a cost plus markup that they are working. So will this be a simple transfer pricing arrangement, or that could be complex? So I think you have explained a lot of other analogies that how to determine which model to apply to. But still, if you want to answer a little bit on this question.
Correct. So to summarize, a cost plus or maybe a percentage of sales for a distributor can be an appropriate model. But yeah, having said that, what is more relevant to understand is that how that subsidiary is functioning in terms of characterization, in terms of like they are, what is the role and whether they are taking limited role there, and most of the other functions and the risk are still being taken up by India. If they are taking a limited role of distributor, like buying and selling it off to the customers, then a fixed remuneration model will work. A cost plus or a percentage of sales might have to be discussed in a more fact-specific manner. But yeah, this kind of a model might work. But again, it will depend on to what extent actually that transaction is being undertaken.
One more more relevant question here for the audience of our SME community is that a company which has a software service, SaaS, based offering, and it's a Nilesh Morey's question again. He has put in a lot of questions, and I'm taking one of those which was not answered. So a SaaS-based company which is offering services across the globe, where it is, I mean, it can be delivered from India. They don't need a physical setup there. That's what my understanding is from the question. I hope Nilesh is stating the same. So in this case, how will the transfer pricing work? So it's an Indian entity putting a software as a service on the cloud from India. Everything, maintenance, everything, all the risks are being managed in India. And it is being delivered to a foreign entity where probably it may have a marketing or may not, or probably are doing marketing from India and they are getting clients directly from across the globe and they are getting money from there. So probably if they have a small establishment, they are just for taking in money or receiving money and then that being transferred to the holding company. In this case, how will it work?
I think the role of the entity becomes important. Now, think of a situation where the Indian entity was doing all the development and the product creation as well as product operation and maintenance activity. What did you really need the US entity to do? Or let's just say it was a US entity, what do you require it to do? Did you require it to be the customer-facing entity? Did you require it because the US customers insisted that they wanted a customer, customer-facing legal entity in the US? And to what extent did that US entity play a role? And I think that in that case, if the US entity really has a role to play in the so-called distribution of software, and largely distribution would mean one, that it is entering into customer contracts whereby delivery may be happening through the US entity. In reality, the US entity becomes like what is called as a service distributor. And because it maintains the customer relationship, it enters into contracts, it could get something like a distributor return, which could be benchmarked. Maybe the answer is going to be 2-4%, but that is the kind of return that it could receive in the SaaS model. Of course, the question is going to be that, let's say the US entity exists and is doing this function. Maybe if you go to, let's say, the Middle East, you might not even need an entity, just hypothetically. Or you go to Europe, you might not even need an entity. You might be able to deliver services fully from India. In which case, the question of giving any entity any return there is of no consequence. Of course, there's another different debate that is currently taking place, which is that if countries are able to operate in other jurisdictions without a presence, then aren't they exploiting the market? Aren't they participating in the economic life of a country without physical presence, without paying taxes in that jurisdiction? because there are no profits allocated to that jurisdiction. But that's a different discussion, which eventually will see the light of day whenever it does. But I think at the moment, yes, and of course, some countries have instituted measures like digital services tax. Mm-hmm. But short point being, this is how a SaaS model could operate.
Thank you. And there's another question to that extent. There is, are there any specific factors needed to be taken care of in case of a subsidiary company while doing a TP audit? So that's Anjana Arora's question.
So I'll take this. Suchint, I'll take this. So with regard to a subsidiary company, so there is no, I'll say there is no specific factor that anything that with regard to a subsidiary company or something which has to be taken care of. Irrespective of whatsoever the nature is, what has to be taken care of is that during TP audit, how robust is our documentation, one, and then second, during the audit, how quickly can we address the issue of what characterization which we have done is correct, in the sense that at the end of the day, if we are able to demonstrate, say with invoicing, we are able to demonstrate that we are the one who are doing the invoicing. We are the one, we say we are able to demonstrate that it's Indian market and we are the one who is entering, who is discussing with the customers, who is identifying the market. As long as we are able to demonstrate the functional profile and the risk profile with the backup documents, depending on the kind of transaction, I think that is what is required broadly during a TP audit, irrespective of whether it's a subsidiary or whether any other company, as long as the transaction is being justified correctly.
Go ahead, sir.
Yeah, I just want to add one point there. I think it is quite tempting for a company in India to say that, I achieved 23%, therefore I'll opt for the safe harbor, even though it may have a subsidiary in the US that is doing the distribution activity, for example. So think of India doing development, product ownership, and the US entity being the distributor, and the Indian entity ending up at 23% and saying, safe harbor is at 17, so why don't I go in for safe harbor? And that's how I'm going to benchmark the Indian company. But the fact is that when we look at and specific to Anjana's question, is there a factor that needs to be taken care of in subsidiary? It really is that, what is the role of the subsidiary? And if the subsidiary is the less complex entity, is not truly the entrepreneurial entity, then that's the entity that has to be benchmarked. Even though you might fit a margin to a safe harbor, but the classical answer or the good answer is not to say, the convenient answer is safe harbor. That's a convenient answer, but that's not the right answer. The right answer is give the US entity, for example, a 2% return, and that's the correct answer. That's the transfer pricing classic answer, because that's the simpler entity. So that's how you take care of subsidiary issues.
Okay, lovely. Thanks. Thank you. And one last, not the least, there's a question from Raj Shekhar. He says that, can we have a pass-through cost without margin incorporated in a TP agreement? So that means there's no cost plus. It is just a cost passing through a TP agreement. That's what I understand from his question. But
the heart of the matter is, you have to allocate profits where value is created. Yeah. If pass-through cost means that ostensibly there is no value created, then yes, there is an argument to say that the pass-through cost can be without a margin because there is no value created. But it is rare to have pass-through costs ordinarily, because there is, in the context of maybe supervision, in the context of maybe finding out which is the entity that can render the service, which is the subject of the pass-through. So there are normally some activities performed that are peripheral or that are ancillary to the cost that is the subject of the pass-through. So ordinarily we don't see pass-through costs. It's very rare, but it's not something that can't be argued if the cases are built around saying that I'm performing this purely as an agent, I add no value to this, I'm doing this because I got, let's say, my money in advance and I'm simply conduit, not that conduit is a good word, but nevertheless, I'm only a a pass-through. Therefore, I am paying a cost-to-cost transact compensation. But like I said, those instances are very rare and very fact-specific.
Thanks a lot. Thanks a lot, Pratik and Sujit. This is a very interesting subject, and though it is so complex that it cannot be explained in 1 or 2 hours, though I think we overshoot almost half an hour from our time. But yeah, I think, audience was getting interested and they were asking so many questions. So probably in the later stages, if with the feedbacks from all the members who had participated, if they are interested to get deep dive into any of the other subjects relevant to us, probably we can look at a follow-up session on this with your consent and your availability as well. And we'll keep our members posted with this. Thank you. Thanks a lot. And I would also like to call upon Gagan, who's our director, senior director at NASSCOM for GTD, Global Trade Development. And he would like to take this opportunity to speak to our members for opportunities on market access in Europe and Japan. So Gagan, it's over to you.
Thank you. Thank you, Mukesh bhai. Good to see you. Long time, and good afternoon to everyone, all of you participants. I will not take much of time, but if I'm allowed to share my screen, I don't know who's sharing the screen. If you can stop doing that.
Yeah.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Pruthi. So ladies and gentlemen, I'm Gagan Sabharwal, part of the NASSCOM Global Trade Development Team. And we've been working in various markets, specifically non-English speaking markets, where it gets a little difficult for our companies to find a foothold. And I have a proposition for all of you. I'll just take 5 or 10 minutes to bring you up the speed on what we're trying to do and how it helps you. So basically, we've been running series of business matching sessions in this pandemic era where we are not allowed to go out and meet with customers. Travel is not open. Participating in delegations that we used to do is not possible. Fairs are not happening. Exhibitions are not happening. But if you are a company and an SME company wanting to get connected with customers with a qualified lead to talk about and not just meet with them, on a casual basis, but if you're interested in meeting with such customers who have articulated their need to us, then we can possibly help you. We've done, we've created this model in last 5 months or so, which I would like to bring to you. And let me now quickly share with you, what this idea is all about. I hope you guys can see my screen. So this is about the business matching session with the Enterprise Connect, especially during this time when we are all working from home without any travel, without any delegation, without any without any trade fairs or exhibitions. So how we do it is that, we've done this and we create a program. This is again, virtual program, but this is one-on-one business matching where you meet with your customers in a virtual private room and you have a one-on-one discussion for 40 minutes or so. In a situation where language is a problem, we also arrange for an interpreter to be present in your room to help you do the translation. So normally what we do is we have, we identify a theme with our agencies, with our partners in these targeted geos. And this happens on Zoom itself, where 15 or 20 companies from these target geos come online, talk about their problems, talk about the challenges that they're trying to solve. So we're doing this with multiple geographies in Asia, in Europe. So you will, see Taiwan and Japan or Europe elsewhere. But we identify the focus of, some of these sessions is agreed upon between the organizers on both sides. Typically, it's all about under the IT, what we do. So engineering services, embedded, AI, IoT, machine to machine, blockchain, even, bodies for hire. In case you're wanting to work with the customer who's looking for, let's say, 5 resources for a particular technologies, those are also the kind of leads that we do receive from, these geos. Now, how this one-on-one format works, this is a chart that showcase you. How we work this out. So on a specified given time, you will see EU company 1, 2, 3, 4, on your left hand side. So what we do is we keep a 30 minutes or a 40 minute slot, depending on whether interpretation is required or not required. If not required, then half an hour slot. So one EU company, after they've articulated their requirement, meets with four different companies that we match basis, you know, if you're interested in joining such sessions. So then they have one-on-one discussions with them, and then they shortlist which one of them has a better proposition or a similar use case, domain expertise, vertical capabilities, technology capabilities, and then, you know, we move on. So in case the company requires an interpretation support, then we provide you with the interpretation support in your one-on-one private virtual room as well. Now, the question, logical question would be, what kind of leads are articulated? So on your screen, I've put forward some three or four leads. You know, this is the kind of information that we receive. We receive a lot of information. I'm not able to showcase all of that information in this small slide deck, but you know, I'm just giving you an example. These are the genuine leads, the leads that we've received in the past. So for example, Simith, you know, Healthliners is looking for, you know, this intelligent solution where they're identifying a partner with, which helps them do patients matching within the hospital setup. And not just patients matching with their face recognition, et cetera, but also the hospital staff, et cetera. The other one is Wise Automation. As you see, they, you know, they are a mid-sized German company, 500 employees, looking to have you know, joint venture, working things out on smart factory area, remote tracking, AR, VR, digital twin solutions, et cetera. Plus, they're also looking for an ERP implementation vendor and who can provide the help desk support. And these are some of the ideas. So we get leads from various verticals, including maritime, shipbuilding. We you know, had a similar requirements from specifically from Europe and from Japan as well. You see the utilities companies, you know, which is EDF from France, which is one of the biggest PSUs in France. And they were looking in mobility area, smart infrastructures, digital meter, how do you capture digital readings, et cetera, et cetera. So this just gives you an idea the kind of requirements that we get through our efforts. Now, we've already done about five of these sessions with Japan, with Switzerland, with EU already. So in we started in October, and till date, we've done about five. The last one happened yesterday. These are virtual buyer-seller meets, or should I say business matching, you know, requirements. About 55 companies till date have joined these sessions from the targeted geos. 50% of these companies were represented at the C-level, at the founder level, or the business decision-maker level. And we've been able to accomplish about 220-plus kind of one-on-one meetings for our Indian companies till date. On the right-hand side of the screen, you see some screenshots of the meetings happening in one-on-one rooms. So just this slide gives you a timeline, how we started and what's in store for you in the future. As I said, we started in October. We did with Osaka, where we had 15 leads. We also did with SwissMem, which is Switzerland, with about 11 leads. In November, we did the European wide program. We, you know, the buyer seller needs in November. December was a you know, break. And in January, we again did a program with Deloitte in Japan. In that was in January. February, as I said, yesterday and day before, we completed again with the EU setup. Now in next 3 months from now, which is March, April, May, we have five more lined up, which is with Kobe, Japan, Kyoto, Japan, Heidelberg in Germany, and with a couple of our partners in EU as well as in Japan. So five done, five more lined up in the next 3 months, which possibly will help you know, our SME community get in front of the customer while we're working in this setup. This is the feedback that we received. I'll leave this for you know, a few seconds so that you can read through. Most of the companies that participate in the program are small to mid-sized companies on our side. And I'll just say over here that, you know, actually the feedback that we've received for this format is phenomenal. You know, we used to do this one-on-one, but this virtual setup is working out nicely because you have a need in front of you. And if you have a case study to match that need, you can bring in your expert who can talk about how you've done or how you solved that particular problem in the same vertical. And, you know, your expert could be sitting in US, in India or Japan or elsewhere. So, you know, you're not asking your sales guys to go there, qualify a lead and then bring in the subject matter expert. So in this virtual format, you bypass, you know, those couple of steps and you bring in the subject matter expert in the first meeting itself. So you're in shortening the sales cycle time at the moment. Keep in mind, we are incurring a lot of costs to enable this. So the cost for joining in these sessions will be about per meeting slot about 10,000 to 25,000 depending on the nature of your membership that you have. So it's not a free program, it's a paid program, because we have to incur a lot of costs to get these kind of details from the customer before they join in the session. So, you know, which is a very big pain area. So this is what we wanted to share with you. If you guys are interested, then please reach out to us. Neha is fine. You reach out to Neha and we'll get you in slotted for the next sessions, as and when they happen. But in case, just one last slide, in case some of you are in that startup / SME growth phase where you're trying to or wanting to raise capital as well, then there's a separate engine that we have started, separate platform that we have started, where we connect you with the VC community, which is the investor community in all of these four geos. So in Japan today, we have about 200 investors part of this platform. Europe, we have about 75 plus investors. Singapore, almost 100 now, and Korea as well. So these are the four regions, four countries where we can help you get connected in case you are looking to raise capital for your next round. If you happen to be in that domain, then the link is on the screen. You can visit this link. It will give you the information. So I'll rest my case over here. In case you have any questions, happy to take them now or take them offline. Thank you. Mukesh bhai, over to you.
Mute. I'm sorry, I was on mute. Thank you, Gagan. Thanks a lot for this information. And I think I have participated in one or two of your these virtual sessions that you have been doing. They are fantastic. The kind of audience is also very good. So I think let more and more members get benefit out of this, and probably it's a kind of a marketing or event without going to that country, and that's a lot of cost saving as well. So I think people should try and look at this option, and you guys are doing a good job. So Japan, do you guys are also doing now China? No, I mean, or you have stopped China now?
China, we have been advised by government of India to maintain status quo, till the time the border situation resolves itself. So as of now, we are holding on to our horses.
Okay, thanks. Thanks a lot. I think the members will get back to you. And I think, Gagan, most of the members know you very well, who have been in NASSCOM as a member, would not be able to not know you, right? So thanks a lot. And thanks to our panel experts, Prateek and Sujit. And we will get back to you also on if there is a good feedback from the members. However, I see itself on the chat, people are saying that it went well and that was very informative for them. So we'll talk to you about if there is a second session on a specific requirement of our NASSCOM member teams. So this was a broad explanation towards transfer pricing, but we could go into a specific need of a typical SME of a NASSCOM member, and then probably we can deep dive there. And if your availability is there, we can conduct that session again. Thank you, Neha, for organizing this wonderful session. And thank you all for participating. With that, we'll say
bye. I just want to put in a special word for Gagan. I know Gagan and we've been working through the Deloitte Connect and therefore really appreciate all your contributions to the startup initiatives and the SME initiatives, Gagan. I think while we spoke about transfer pricing, but in a way, you first need to get the company into that country, and then we can do everything else that goes with it.
So we should have done his session first before your TP, right?
That's right.
No, thank you. No, thank you. It's all part and parcel of the thing, you know. I couldn't join in because I was actually part of the other meeting. But this virtual setup is phenomenal. You know, you can be in a meeting with Japan and then straight.